Keeping in mind all these things, we will progress with the session. First of all, I'd like to call upon our chairperson, Chairperson Dr. Shobhna Shah. Dr. Shobhna Shah, sir, please come and take your seat. He is a senior divisional medical officer with the Indian Railway Medical Services, at present working in Alipurduar Railway Hospital, North Frontier Railway. He is an anesthetist as well as a pain physician, trained at Dardia Pain Clinic and one of the founder members of the Dardia Pain Foundation. And I'd like to call upon our second chairperson, Dr. Shaman Maiti. Dr. Shaman Maiti. Okay, so we'll continue. So, coming to our first topic, the first speaker, Dr. Jaya Chaturvedi. MD Anesthesiology in Prosthesis from AMU Aligarh, and she has completed her training in interventional pain management under the guidance of Dr. Gautam Das, and presently working as Consultant Department of Anesthesia and Pain Services at Medica Super Specialty Hospital, Kolkata. The third part is the display equipment.
Once the X-rays are converted to visual form, they are transferred to the monitor or a recording system. Apart from these three major parts, there are few features in every fluoroscoping machine which help not only in producing better quality image, but they also help in minimizing X-ray exposure to the staff, physician and the patients. First and foremost is the collimator. The collimator decreases the size of the beam. As a result, the area of the patient which is exposed to the radiation is less. Then there are anti-scatter grids which reduce scatter radiation, and another radiation limiting device is the other filters. Filters help by absorbing the low energy radiation. Now coming to the biology of the radiation. The harmful effects of X-rays can basically broadly be divided into two. One is the deterministic or the determining effect, the other one is the cytokinetic effect. The determining effect occurs because of the direct damage to the cell components. This is dose dependent, that is, a particular dose threshold needs to be achieved before these effects occur. Hair loss, cataract, infertility and skin burns are the examples. The other side effect, that is the cytokinetic effect, this occurs because of the DNA damage and it is dose independent. That is, it follows all or none. The effects like cancer and leukemias are the examples. The DNA damage may occur either directly as a result of interaction of the X-ray photons with the DNA or as a result of interaction of the free radicals and other products. No amount of radiation can be considered safe for living matter. However, this is a table which is showing the yearly maximum doses, radiation doses. It varies, as we can see in this table, it varies from 5 rem for the full body to up to 50 rem for thyroid and extremities. Similarly, this is also a table showing minimal pathological dose to the target organ and their side effects. Now, when fluoroscopy is being used in an OT, we are basically exposed to three kinds of radiation. One is the primary radiation, second one is the scattered radiation, and the third one is the residual radiation. Primary radiation is that radiation which is leaving the X-ray tube. If fluoroscopy is used properly, it is only the patient who is exposed to the primary radiation. Once the primary radiation strikes the patient, it is redirected in different directions, leading to scattered radiation. This one is very important because this is the primary source of exposure to the physician as well as the staff inside the OT. Now, once the X-ray penetrates the patient's tissues, some amount of it is absorbed, whereas some of it passes through the patient as residual radiation. This is the useful radiation, that is, this is the radiation which is captured by the image intensifier to produce the desired image. Now, as I told in the previous slide, scattered radiation is very important because this is the primary source of radiation exposure to the patient as well as the staff inside the OT. And scattered radiation occurs as a result of Compton effect, that is, X-ray photons interact with the patient tissues and are redirected in different directions as scattered radiation. Again, there are few factors which determine the amount of scattered radiation. These are voltage, collimation area and the thickness of the skin. More the voltage, higher energy X-rays are produced, more will be scattering. Larger is the collimation area, more will be scattering. Thickness of the skin, more obese the patient, more will be scattering. Now, we'll take up the various principles of radiation protection one by one. First and foremost is maintain the X-ray source to the tabletop distance as large as possible. As we can see in this picture, the X-ray source is at the bottom of the table and image intensifier is at the top of the patient. So, we must always maintain the X-ray source at as large area as possible from the table, whereas image intensifier, that is at the top, should be closest to the patient. This principle can be justified by this picture. If we see the position 1, which is the ideal one, the X-ray tube at the bottom of the table, it is at the largest distance, whereas image intensifier is closest. If we see here, the X-ray exposure is 1 dose unit. Whereas in position 3, which is exactly the opposite, the image intensifier is away from the patient and the X-ray tube is very close to the patient. So the X-ray exposure is around 4 dose units, that is around 4 times more than the position 1. So here the X-ray exposure is around 4 times the position 1. Second principle is, hold the X-ray tube below the patient's table. The X-ray tube should be below the patient's table and image intensifier should be on the top of the patient. Why? As we can see in this picture, X-ray tube is at the below the table. So X-rays are traveling from below upwards. As a result, whatever scattering is happening, it's towards the floor, that is towards the lower extremities of the staff and the physician. Whereas, if we hold the X-ray tube above, the X-rays will be traveling downwards and scattering will be more upwards, leading to exposure to the head, neck, thorax and other vital structures of the patient. Third very important principle, keep away from the source of radiation. This can be explained by the fact that exposure to the X-rays is inversely proportional to the square of distance. In other words, if we double the distance from the X-ray source, the X-ray amount will be reduced by one-fourth. It is recommended, whenever possible and practical, to stand at least 3 meters away from the source of radiation. Now, as we are aware, when we are using, when we are doing pain interventions, we usually do them in AP view, oblique view and lateral view. So, it is very important to know about the scatter profile, that is the area which has the highest scatter radiation density. The area of high scatter intensity is at the skin entrance point of the patient, that is at the end where X-ray tube is there. So as we can see in this picture, the X-ray tube is here and the X-ray scattering is around 2 to 3 times of the dose, whereas at the image intensifier and it is just 0.5 of the dose. This is very important, especially in lateral view and the oblique view. Always stand on the image intensifier end of the patient rather than on the X-ray tube. Why? Because scattering is much more here as compared to this area. Now, another very important principle is set the tube current values as low as possible. As we have discussed in the previous slide, that more the tube current values, more X-rays will be generated. So, set them as low as practically possible. Then set the highest voltage that gives the combination of lowest dose to the patient and optimal image quality. Another important is to keep the exposure time brief. Most of the X-rays have an alarm which to track the exposure time. This alarm sounds after 5 minutes of the radiation. Instead of using a continuous view or a cine view, save the last image for analysis. Use pulse mode instead of using continuous mode. Another principle is that if the primary beam passes through the center of the patient, the scattered radiation will be less as compared to when it passes through the lateral side of the patient. Although this is not always practically possible, but still it can be. Wherever possible, this should be kept in mind. All the fluoroscopic devices must undergo regular technical checks. What happens that, as I told you, that the function of image intensifier is not only to capture the image and capture the X-rays and produce an image, but also it accelerates the optical photon so that we get an intensified image. What happens that when the fluoroscopy machine is used for a long time, this capacity to accelerate the optical photons is lost. As a result, more X-rays will be needed to produce the same quality of image. Therefore, it's very important for the X-rays to undergo regular technical checks. Only necessary professionals should be inside the OT. The hand and the head of the physician should never directly come inside the primary beam. operator, whoever is operating the X-ray, must be trained regularly for their own safety as well as that of the patient. Even when we follow these safety principles, we will be exposed to radiation. So it is very important that all the staff as well as physicians who are working in the fluoroscopy suit must wear protective clothing such as lead aprons, skirts, vests, thyroid protectors and gloves. These barriers, we have to keep in mind that these barriers do reduce the amount of radiation, but they will never completely stop it. An ideal lead apron should start from the manubrium sternum and end just above the knee. A lead apron can absorb around 90 to 95% of the scattered radiation. A lead apron should ideally must be around 0.5 millimeters thick. And it should not be folded or wrinkled and must undergo regular checks to rule out any breaks or tears. Again, we often overlook the thyroid shields, but when worn, they protect our neck and thyroid. Again, it should be around 0.5 millimeters of thickness. Protective gloves of 0.25 millimeter thickness are helpful for protecting our hands from the primary beam. Protective eyeglasses are also available with clear lenses. They have around 0.35 millimeter lead thickness and they significantly reduce the amount of scattered radiation reaching the eyes. Now, even when we are following those safety principles and we are using those protective equipment, still another important part is to monitor the radiation. The International Committee for Radiation Exposure has recommended that annual total body X-ray exposure should not exceed 50 millisieverts. This X-ray exposure can be measured utilizing various dosimeters. We most commonly we use TLD badges. If the hands are exposed a lot, then we can wear ring dosimeters inside the lead aprons, inside the gloves. The TLD badges should be worn on the chest pocket inside the lead apron. This is the most commonly used TLD badges that we utilize for monitoring the radiation. In the end, I would like to say that fluoroscopy is the cornerstone for various interventional pain procedures. Still, with it, it brings lots of risks and dangers. So, use it in a safe manner. Be aware and use it in a safe manner. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jaya, for your nice and brief lectures. At this moment, I'd again like to introduce to you our second chairperson who has already joined us, Dr. Shyamal.